Item number, SCP-120. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. Due to its importance to the Foundation, SCP-120 is to be kept under video surveillance and armed guard at all times. Any personnel attempting to utilize the item without authorization are to be terminated immediately. All personnel wishing to use the item are required to submit a filled copy of the application form to facility operators. Due to the precise timing and coordination required for efficient use of this object in an emergency, all personnel entering SCP-120's building are placed under temporary command of the facility heads, Captain Security Detachment L4, and Dr. Research Team L4. All destination locations are to be kept under surveillance and armed guard. They are valuable to the Foundation, but are non-critical. But any compromised destination must be immediately reported to SCP-120 personnel. Distributed Task Force Sigma-6, Puddle Jumpers, was created with the objective of protecting and maintaining SCP-120's facility and location outposts. It consists of one command unit and one defense and maintenance unit based at the SCP-120 facility at command, 5 units based at the destination locations, plus 5 reserve units for these, and 5 units assigned to other SCP-120 related projects. Description: SCP-120 appears to be a small child's paddling pool, pastel pink in coloration, with an inner diameter of approximately 2.5 meters, an inner height of 0.3 meters. The pool appears to have been fabricated from common earth plastics, but has shown itself to be indestructible by any attempted means. The pool's structure and response to pressure are typical for such a pool. It will flex when pressure is applied, and is soft to the touch, but has amazing tensile strength, and cannot be permanently stretched or ripped. What is constrained within the pool seems to be a brightly glowing, colored, liquid-like substance, which seems to exist only partially in our dimension. It is unresponsive to manipulation by organic or inorganic means, but the substance ripples and shimmers systematically and regularly, suggesting it exists physically on another dimension. SCP-120's most interesting and useful property is used regularly by Foundation personnel. Human beings, when alive and carrying loads, including clothing, under 37.8 kilograms, are observed to fall through the pool and are deposited at one of 11 destinations. The item will only function in this way if certain conditions are met. The subject must be genetically human. The subject must be conscious. The subject must be carrying weights of under the specified amount. And only one subject must be present on the surface. Test subjects attempting to use SCP-120 while these conditions were not met reported their feet making contact with a smooth surface underneath the liquid, but no significant effects were observed. SCP-120's main use is as a potential means of evacuation for command during a major emergency. It is currently stored and maintained in a fortified outbuilding of this facility. SCP-120 was first brought to the attention of Foundation authorities on 31/08/1992. Local police authorities in California were investigating reports of missing children in their jurisdiction and discovered and reported the item on 31/08. Overwatch Command was automatically informed through the usual channels, and a small team of Foundation agents was dispatched to claim and transport the item to Site-19, where it remained for testing over the next 2 years. It was transferred to its present location at Command in 1994. Addendum: Document 127. Destructive test results for SCP-120, 24/12/1993, abridged version. Hand saw, 30 centimeters, no result. Industrial drill, steel bit, no result. Industrial drill, diamond bit, no result. Munition, 9x19mm parabellum, no result. Munition, 5.56x45mm NATO, no result. Munition, 7.62x39mm, no result. Munition, 120mm M830 heat, no result. Cutting torch, acetylene, no result. Cutting torch, hydrogen, no result. Cutting torch, propane, no result. CO2 laser, peak power, 100 kilowatts, no result. CO2 laser, peak power, 500 kilowatts. No result. Document 12010. Detailed explanation of SCP-120's capabilities and destinations. 1202-1994, abridged version. SCP-120 possesses the capability of instant translocation of human beings, possibly through one or more alternate dimensions. Subjects using the item are invariably deposited at one of 11 locations. These locations cycle in a specific and unchanging pattern. The 11 destinations and their locations were determined through testing with Class D personnel carrying radio beacons. Location 1. Pacific Ocean. SCP-120's liquid displays a blue glow while connected to this destination. Subjects attempting travel to this destination are deposited an average of 2 meters above the surface of the Pacific, latitude and longitude undisclosed. A Foundation ship, SCPS Demeter, publicly the USS Nassau, a meteorological ship, is currently stationed at this location, and personnel arriving through use of SCP-120 materialize inside the ship's cargo hold. Sensitive Foundation material or personnel can be sent here in an emergency, and the ship has provisions for storage of low-threat SCP objects, should the need arise. Class D personnel used to dial SCP-120 can be confined and extracted by a helicopter, or reused, or simply terminated, and their bodies retained in storage. The original Class D and radio transmitter used to determine this location were lost at sea, and might have to be recovered in the interest of secrecy, if they were to wash up on populated shores. This configuration of SCP-120 was arbitrarily designated as number 1, and has no observable significance above other configurations. Destinations 2 through 11 follow in sequential order after this configuration, and return to it after a full cycle. Travel by SCP-120 to this location is not advisable during storms, due to risk of injury. Location 2. Greenland. SCP-120 displays a bright white glow while dialed to this destination. Subjects traveling to this destination materialize 1.5 meters above the surface of Greenland, latitude and longitude undisclosed. A small facility was established here, under the public pretense of oil industry expansion. This facility has similar capabilities and use to the Demeter, and is additionally equipped with an airstrip and refueling facilities. Location 3. L3. Located at the Earth-Moon Lagrange Point 3, the SCP displays a deep black color. Objects and personnel sent through the SCP to any Lagrange point, locations 3, 5, 8, 10, and 11, are effectively lost, as retrieval is impossible at our current level of technology. They may prove a possible way to remove small but threatening SCP objects, but for now, are merely an inconvenience, as sacrifice of D personnel is required to move the SCP to its next configuration. Location 4. Himalayas. SCP-120 displays a white glow similar to when it is dialed to Location 2. Materialization occurs on a mountain in the Himalayan mountain range, latitude and longitude undisclosed. Only minor changes have been made to the destination, the digging of an 8-meter hole for disposal of D-class bodies, an overhead canopy for concealment, and supplies and testing for evacuation to this location, which should only take place in extreme circumstances. D-class personnel used for dialing are to be injected with a mixture of sedatives and neurotoxin before sending, to ensure a humane death, and decrease risk of damage to the structures at Location 4. Location 5, L5, identical to Location 3. Location 6, Sahara. SCP-120 will glow yellow. Personnel materialize at a small outpost, latitude and longitude undisclosed. The need for secrecy renders this facility unable to house any significant SCP object, but is ideal for evacuation of personnel and documents from command. Location 7. Gobi. SCP-120 displays a brown glow. This destination is located in a small outpost in the Gobi Desert, latitude and longitude undisclosed, but is otherwise identical to the Location 6 outpost. Location 8, L2, identical to Location 3, although shows more potential for SCP disposal, being situated beyond the moon. Location 9, Mare Imbrium. The SCP displays a subdued gray glow when dialed into this destination, This destination is on a relatively flat section of the Sea of Rains, on the lunar surface. Through vast expenditure of money and D-class personnel, a small outpost has been established there and is considered one of the Foundation's safest locations. Location 10, L4, identical to Location 3. Location 11, L1, identical to Location 3. Item number, SCP-004. Object Class, Euclid. Special Containment Procedures. When handling items SCP-004-2 through SCP-004-13, proper procedure is vital. The items are not permitted to be moved off-site unless accompanied by two Level 4 security personnel. Under no circumstances should any other component of SCP-004 be taken through SCP-004-1. The effects of doing so are as yet unknown, and the current cost of experimentation makes further research impractical. Should any of the objects contained within SCP-004-1 breach containment, or the facility be breached, the keys must be brought inside and the door closed prior to activation of Site-62's on-site warhead. Unauthorized removal of keys from the testing area is grounds for immediate termination. Level 1 clearance is required for basic access to SCP-004-1. Level 4 clearance is required for use of SCP-004-2-13. Description: SCP-004 consists of an old wooden barn door, SCP-004-1, and a set of 12 rusted steel keys, SCP-004-2 through SCP-004-13. The door itself is the entrance to an abandoned factory and data expunged. Chronological history. July 2nd, 1949. A group of three juveniles trespassing on federal property near find the door. According to their testimony, they found a set of rusted keys in an iron lockbox and determined what door the keys unlock. The juveniles are taken into custody after they contact Sheriff when one of their friends, SCP-004-CAS-01, goes missing. July 3rd, 1949. Local authorities find the severed right hand of SCP-004-CAS-01 8 kilometers from SCP-004-1. Other parts of SCP-004-CAS-01's body are found scattered as far as 32 kilometers from the factory. Under interrogation, the apprehended juveniles tell authorities that upon opening the door with one of the keys, SCP-004-CAS-01 was torn into several pieces, each of which disappeared. At this point, the SCP Foundation takes over the investigation. July 4th, 1949. SCP Agent obtains the keys from the local authorities to begin testing. Tests show that SCP-004-2 through SCP-004-13 all fit into a single lock on the large barred door. 12 Class D personnel are assigned to test the effects of the door. Of the 12 test subjects each trying a different key to enter the room, only two survive. Opening the door with any key except SCP-004-7 or SCP-004-12 caused the test subjects to be torn apart in multiple directions. However, no dismembered parts were found until later. At the time of writing, only two parts of each subject have been recovered, with the exception of the subject using SCP-004-1, whose pieces were scattered in close proximity. The others have, for all intents and purposes, vanished from existence. Of the two surviving subjects, only one, having used SCP-004-7, returned unharmed. The other came back in a near catatonic state, able only to remove himself from the room and then collapse on the floor, and had to be restrained to prevent him from gouging out his eyes. The subject using SCP-004-7 said that he had entered a large room, impossibly big for the size of the attached building. After his exit, SCP-004-1 was propped open, and an armed squad of Level 3 personnel entered. The size of the room is impossible to measure, and the doorframe and the individuals in the room are the only part of the room that can be felt or illuminated. July 16, 1949. The juvenile suspects and Sheriff are terminated. August 2nd, 1949. is declared a hazardous area due to unexploded ordnance, and fences erected in order to prevent civilian ingress. Tests to determine safety of exposure to environment behind SCP-004-1 begin. December 1st, 1950. Space-time anomalies resulting from exposure to SCP-004 are confirmed. Testing is suspended until further notice. The unaccounted-for remains of SCP-004-CAS-01 appear unexpectedly outside SCP-004-1. Despite being killed decades before, the remains of SCP-004-CAS-01 are not decomposed in any manner and are still warm to the touch. Blood remains uncoagulated. The remains are remanded for testing. The unaccounted-for remains of one of the 12 original test subjects appear in similar manner to those of SCP-004-CAS-01. The remains have been designated SCP-004-CAS-02. Records suggest that both SCP-004-CAS-01 and CAS-02 used SCP-004-1. March 21st, 1999. With the massive proliferation of nuclear weapons, and World War III only years away, construction has begun on a site inside SCP-004-1. The site is to stock supplies for person days. April 21st, 1999. Has ordered the site inside SCP-004-1 to be expanded to include emergency storage for all mobile SCP specimens and a petabyte database for the storage of all SCP data. The facility is now referred to as Site 62. September 25th, 2000. Site 62 is operational. Labs and containment units are complete and can contain the most dangerous specimens. Backup of the SCP database has begun. January 25th, 2001. Due to time anomalies, see space-time anomalies below. All personnel working at Site 62 are now required to reside on site permanently. Families of personnel are to be informed that loved ones perished in an industrial accident. Cloned bodies have been prepared for funeral. August 14, 2003. Massive power outage across Northeast United States and throughout Canada. Due to the initial failure of multiple SCP generators, Site 62 was without power for 53 minutes. During those 53 minutes, those on site were completely without any source of light. They reported sensing creatures and people, although no abnormal entities could be seen or felt. Selected facility personnel were allowed to read Appendix A, and said the creatures sensed were of humanoid size, but otherwise similar to the massive green creature described. Space-time anomalies. SCP-004 seems to propagate spatio-temporal anomalies. Personnel leaving the facility report losing time. Those who have been in the site for weeks insist that they had only been in the facility for several days, and records of work completed and supplies consumed support their claims. Other temporal anomalies involve SCP-004-2 through 13, especially the reappearance of SCP-004-CAS-01 and SCP-004-CAS-02 exactly years after using SCP-004-1. Has been assigned to investigate all aspects of these time anomalies. Spatial anomalies include the impossibly large dimensions of the area opened by SCP-004-7. Similarly, the 2003 blackout incident suggests that there exists an alternate plane of existence within the same space that Site 62 occupies. Additional notes. Testing on SCP-004 reveals that 10 of the keys open SCP-004-1 on a dimension where the laws of physics and topology are significantly different than those of our home dimension. Test subjects meeting these hostile conditions are torn apart, their body parts deposited in various locations, only three of which have been verified to be on Earth. Material deposited at two of these points appears immediately. Material deposited at the third appears exactly years into the future. The other seven locations are currently unknown. Current testing focuses on two avenues of research. The first is finding ways to survive SCP-004's hostile topologies. The second, data expunged, suggests that SCP-004-2 through 13 may open doors other than SCP-004-1. Appendix A, Mental Health Effects of SCP-004-12. All Class D personnel using SCP-004-12 return in a catatonic state, unable to speak. Some may have enough energy left to try to claw out their eyes. Of the 16 subjects, only 4 have survived. Only 1 has regained speech following long-term psychotherapy. He was able to tell the psychiatrist that he saw a massive green creature, so large that much of its body extended beyond his field of view. He reported innate fear and sudden recognition, as if it were something buried deep in his primal fears, and forced implantation of incomprehensible memories. Subject displays acute anterograde and retrograde amnesia. Appendix B, additional information. Item number, SCP-004-14. Date of discovery, September 2nd, 1950. Origin of object. Object was discovered elsewhere in factory area, in the previously undiscovered manager's office. Description. Object appears as a large unvarnished wooden box. The box may be unlocked by the safe key, SCP-004-7, as well as 5 of the unsafe keys. Upon unlocking SCP-004-14 with SCP-004-7, the box opens automatically on hinges. The volume of the space inside is precisely 5 times greater than the outer dimensions imply. Items placed within while the lid remains open do not affect the weight or any other properties of the box. When the lid is closed and locked, however, all items inside vanish irretrievably. Personnel locked inside the box are also irretrievable, although losing personnel in this fashion appears to affect significantly the dreams experienced by data expunged. Item number, SCP-084. Object class, Euclid. Special Containment Procedures. SCP-084 is currently under a full non-interaction order until the full extent of the emission waves has been evaluated. A continuous surveillance watch is to be maintained around the active area of SCP-084, with the primary objective of civilian misdirection and external surveillance. With no major roads, trails, or other travel routes nearby, any civilians encountered approaching SCP-084 are to be deemed suspect and detained for evaluation. Under no circumstances are any Foundation or civilian personnel allowed into the active area of SCP-084, except with express vocal and written permission of no fewer than 2 members of O5 Command. Sentries are to maintain their posted position with line-of-sight contact checks on fellow sentries, in conjunction with compass and landmark checking. All reference points should be well outside the active area of SCP-084. Should any sentry fail to report in via vocal roll call, full recall orders will be issued to all sentries, and containment will be re-evaluated by special response teams. In the event of active area fluctuation, full recall orders are to be assumed by all active sentries, followed by appropriate action. No form of radio, GPS, television, cell phone, video camera, still picture camera, or any other recording or electronic media devices are permitted within 100 meters of the active area around SCP-084. Civilians found with such devices within this area are to have said devices confiscated and destroyed immediately. Any recordings collected, data expunged. Description. SCP-084 appears to be a large radio tower, positioned in the center of a large open field with 2 small outbuildings. Direct observation and sample collection from SCP-084 is impossible, due to the effect that is emitted around and from SCP-084. SCP-084 appears to emit a form of wave, or radiation, that has a detrimental effect on local space-time reality. The most pronounced aspect of this is the alteration of local space within the active area of SCP-084. Externally, the active area forms a rough dome shape of 200 meters in diameter. SCP-084 appears inside this area at random points, appearing to jump at random times, sometimes even appearing in multiple locations at once inside the active area. Internally, the space appears to be unlimited, with SCP-084 at the center. SCP-084 is impossible to reach due to the emitted effect. Attempts to approach SCP-084 within the active area have returned the observation that SCP-084 retains its relative position on the horizon, even after 3 months and 12 days of dedicated direct travel, both by vehicle and on foot. Termination tests have proven impossible, as no means of destruction are capable of physically reaching SCP-084, even when entered from outside the active area. Local space will also distort periodically. This will cause relative distances to randomly extend or contract in a flicker, causing buildings or objects to suddenly jump thousands of meters away or rush up to other points, sometimes even causing overlaps. These overlaps have a markedly detrimental effect on living tissue. The town of is assumed to have been situated in or around the original manifestation of the active area. This town is no longer observable from outside the active area, appearing only once inside the active area. The town has maintained the same population, 343 humans, for the duration of its encapsulation. Births appear to be impossible, along with normal aging patterns. Suicide and/or homicide appear to be circumvented by the area of effect, with dead subjects flickering and appearing alive and unharmed several seconds after death. There are also reports of events rewinding, causing things like mortal wounds to visibly freeze and close. Subjects appear to exhibit many events of inconsistent space-time, as do most structures. Electronic devices and recording equipment do not function correctly in or around the active area. Subjects report bizarre or unsettling transmissions from video and audio recordings and playback devices. This acts to totally isolate from the outside world, precluding any need for Foundation-enacted containment. It also appears impossible to leave the active area after a random period of time. One subject, found on the grass plain, reported he had been traveling for 6 years. He was found approximately 400 meters from city limits. Log 084-A4. Record of observed anomalous events relating to SCP-084. Detailed observation made of the grass plain making up the majority of the active area. The plain appears to be made of one 10-meter by 10-meter section of grass, repeated endlessly to make up the plain. Sections appear to be randomly rotated as they are formed, causing sections of grass and small ground variations to line up incorrectly. Few non-human organisms appear to exist within the active area. Those outside the active area avoid it, and appear to vanish shortly after entering. Animals observed inside the active area appear normal, but behave strangely. Shuddering movements, sudden shivering, repetitive loops, and other abnormal actions appear to indicate these may not be actual animals. Most animals appear to flicker and vanish after 3 to 4 hours. Vocal communication is difficult within the active area. Vocal communication appears normal within 5 meters of the speaking subject, with reports of a slightly muffled quality reported commonly. Outside of 5 meters, subjects appear to be speaking from a great distance, with a great deal of echoing. Reports of speech being heard several seconds after the subject has stopped talking, and speech occurring with no subject speaking, are also not uncommon. Detailed observation of the radio tower is impossible, due to the inability to physically reach it, and the effect of the broadcast on most observational equipment. Basic telescope or binocular systems show the tower to be hazy and static fogged, while more advanced equipment is subject to the anomalous broadcast effect. Weather patterns, as well as basic day-night cycles, appear to be totally random. Overhead sky will randomly cycle between day, night, clear, and other weather patterns. Relative sun and cloud position appear random as well, with frequent flickering and blurring between different states. Physical alteration or damage to anything within the active area is impossible. Actions such as digging, demolition, and new constructions will suddenly blur and be reset to their previous unaltered state at random points. Subjects inside a reset structure, such as inside a hole, will become instantly trapped and fused. Humans in the active area around SCP-084 exhibit some of the more striking and easily observed reality distortion effects. These include sudden blurring of limbs or head, appearing to suddenly gyrate at violently high speed for several seconds before ending. Subjects experience no pain and are often unaware of this phenomenon. Looping, typically manifested as the repeating of 8 to 20 seconds of time. Subjects will go through an action, example, exiting a doorway, picking up an article of clothing, then suddenly freeze and flicker, then return to the original starting position of the loop, and repeat the action, even if this involves a sudden teleportation of significant distance. Rarely, subjects appear to become caught in a permanent loop. Observation and interrogation of subjects show that basic human needs, such as food, water, and sleep, are no longer required after prolonged exposure to the active area. Some subjects report not having eaten or drank for, they believe, 5 years. One elderly subject also reports having made 2,110 unsuccessful suicide attempts. Subject will sometimes be able to pass through solid matter without incident. These periods appear to last for random periods of time, and begin and end without warning. Subjects inside solid matter when the period ends will become trapped or fused until the period resumes. One subject reports being trapped below the waist in a wall for 2 years. Extreme psychological distress is observed after long-term exposure. The transmission's data expunged barrier, which is compromised over long-term exposure. Subjects in advanced reception states typically reset after several months. Recorded transmissions show a slight data expunged cycles overall. Attempting to catalog and record these broadcasts has therefore been remanded to autonomous systems to preclude any additional loss of Foundation personnel. Item number, SCP-112. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-112 is contained within an abandoned amusement park, designated site. Said site is to be staffed with a standard complement of 12 armed guards in designated amusatastic land garb to prevent civilian interference. SCP-112's power supply is housed within a standard Foundation prefab building with 2 eye security door locks and a standard staff of 6 security staff and 1 operator. Since all other rides in site are intentionally disabled, civilian intervention is low. As the anomalous properties of SCP-112 occur regardless of its condition, only mandatory maintenance work is to be done on SCP-112. This also ensures that local civilians treat SCP-112 and its surroundings as abandoned and ignored. All tests involving SCP-112 must be conducted with a portable toilet nearby, as well as a small table with basic food and drink items. Description: SCP-112 is a steel sit-down roller coaster, formerly known as the Blue Steel Surfer. Built in SCP-112 was marketed as the crown jewel of the amusement park. Initial testing of the ride resulted in extremely negative experiences from testing staff. When these reports became public knowledge, the financial repercussions of the failure of the Steel Surfer resulted in the parent company of the amusement park going bankrupt. The property was abandoned and undisturbed until a local gang broke into the park and reactivated the improperly disabled rides, SCP-112 included. When police attempted to arrest the members who were exiting SCP-112 after its inaugural ride, the riders began to attracting local media attention. Suspecting the ride had traits within its mandate, the Foundation purchased the park under the auspices of rebuilding the park as amusatastic land, in order to test any potential anomalous properties from the ride. When SCP-112 is started, the ride functions as expected until Point Alpha, its primary drop. When a car reaches Point Alpha, the train vanishes. After 3 minutes, the estimated time the train would normally take, the train rematerializes at Point Omega, 3 meters from the coaster's starting point. Human subjects riding SCP-112 have a drastically different experience compared to outside observation. The time frame between Point Alpha and Point Omega is massively extended, with subjective ride times ranging from 4 minutes to several months. The properties of the ride also vary from person to person. Most subjects report elements on the ride that do not exist on the ride proper, like bat wings, cobra rolls, and inclined loops. Subjects do not have any sense that the rest of the world is alien or otherwise different. Only the ride experience is different. Upon exiting the ride, subjects typically experience feelings of confusion and ill health, depending on the subjective time they spent riding SCP-112. These feelings are based not on any physical maladies, but the subjective experience of dealing with a physical malady for an extended period of time. For example, a subject with a subjective ride time of 3 days may experience confusion that he had strong feelings of hunger for most of his ride, but at the end of the ride, he was not hungry at all. Addendum A. Assorted Experiments. Experiment 11234534. Subject. D34534. D34534 was sent on SCP-112 at 2:42 p.m. The train reached Point Alpha at 2:43 p.m. Rematerialization at 2:46 p.m. Upon exiting SCP-112, D34534 quietly asked for aspirin, before passing out. Upon revival and medication, D34534 reported a subjective ride time of 36 minutes, with multiple loops and twists not found on SCP-112's architecture. Experiment 11267564. Subject, D67564. D67564 was sent on SCP-112 at 1:30 p.m. The train reached Point Alpha at 1:31 p.m. Rematerialization at 1:34 p.m. D67564 reported a subjective ride time of 4 minutes, which D67564 reported as enjoyable, with the exception of that part where the car jumps off the track and lands right before the loop. Experiment 112-5893. Subject, D5893. D5893 was sent on SCP-112 at 12:30 p.m. The train reached Point Alpha at 12:31 p.m. Rematerialization at 12:34 p.m. At the end of the ride, D5893 immediately ran to the table with consumables, wordlessly consuming everything he could grab onto, including the wrappers of previously consumed food objects. D5893 became violent when Foundation staff attempted to subdue him, even going so far as to expunge. Upon capture and interviewing, D5893 remained confused and disoriented, continuously saying the phrases, "No food till the ride is over," "Let me sleep," "Let the spinning stop," and 152 lights. The Foundation believes that D5893's statements imply that his subjective ride time was approximately 5 months long, and during his trip he experienced 5 months worth of malnutrition and exhaustion, despite no physical proof of these experiences found. Experiment 112-7556. Subject, D7556, one standard issue camera facing D7556. D7556 was sent on SCP-112 at 11:36 a.m. The train reached Point Alpha at 11:37 a.m. Rematerialization at 11:40 a.m. D7556 experienced symptoms similar, but muted, to those of D5893. During the interview, D7556 explained that his subjective ride time was 1 month and 6 days long. During his trip, he was unable to eat or sleep, and suffered major headaches from SCP-112. D7556 reported experiencing every sort of roller coaster element currently in use, and a few believed to be conceptual. Camera footage lasting 3 minutes shows D7556 sobbing for the duration of the ride, with movement consistent with SCP-112's physical track. Addendum B. Rider Interviews. Experiment 112-35784-23512. Post-Ride Interview 1. Subject, D35784. Interviewer, Dr. Interview Type, Post-Ride Interview. Doctor, how are you feeling, 35784? D35784 rolls eyes. I'm fine. It was just a roller coaster ride, dude. Maybe you have me confused with the other guy. You know, the one that attacked when the ride was over. Doctor, I will, in time. Describe your experience on SCP-112, please. D35784 laughs. What's there to say? Before I was sent to jail, I designed coasters. A couple minutes too long of a ride, you always gotta worry about that. But the twists that thing has are damn good. A few of them I'm pretty sure I mocked up back in the day. It would have been a lot better if the next to me wasn't acting like a damn fool. Doctor, D23512, what was he doing? D35784 sighs. It's what he wasn't doing that pissed me off. He was slouched over so much that his restraints were taut, just facing forward. Think his mouth was open the entire time. If it were possible, I'd say he looked like someone who had been on a crying jag for a few hours. I don't know. When we got that slow point before the banked curve, I tried snapping my fingers in front of him. Idiot just barely turned to face me. And you know what happened afterwards. Doctor, yes, he punched you. D35784. Not really a punch, really. Slapped me, shaking me, trying to choke me. I didn't get the impression that he really wanted to kill me, just wanted to get an answer out of me. That's what he said, actually. Shit, like, why didn't you look at me, and why did you not stop cheering the whole time, in a very hoarse voice? Was in mid-question with another when the guards introduced their rifles to the back of his head. Experiment 112-35784-23512. Post-riot interview 2. Subject, D23512. Interviewer, Dr. Interview type, post-riot interview. Forward. This interview was conducted 3 weeks after riding on SCP-112 with D35784. D23512 is not willing to speak verbally since his ride. From time to time he attempts to speak, but shows signs of discomfort and pain in doing so, stating that his throat is too sore to talk. While there are no medical issues with D23512, his experiences have obviously left him traumatized from his experience on SCP-112. Dr. estimates a full recovery is possible before monthly terminations, and at such time, he will be capable of estimating precisely how long his subjective ride time was. This interview was conducted through written communication. Given his fixation on certain traits of the ride, this transcript has been edited for brevity. Doctor, hello 23512. How are you feeling? D23512. Still hurts. Still dizzy. Loops and loops. Spins, spins, spins. Forever and ever. Doctor, why do you say your throat hurts? D23512. Screamed. Screamed over and over. Girl wouldn't answer me. She never looked at me. I screamed and screamed till I couldn't scream anymore. Throat got better. Screamed again. Never looked, never noticed. Just kept cheering the hell of ups and downs and ups and side to side and side to side. Doctor, I'm assuming you're talking about the person who went on the ride with you. 35784. D23512. Girl with the big jiggling tits. Cheered and laughed and cheered and laughed. Every spin, every turn, every twist. Even when it got dark, I could hear her laughing and wooing. Couldn't sleep because of her laughing and cheering. Light and day, bright and dark, always screaming and giggling. How could she do that? Doctor, she told me you were just sitting there, staring ahead. She said she tried to get your attention, but you never responded. D23512. I waved and shook her. She didn't move, didn't notice, just kept cheering. Tried to tune her out for a few months at a time, but she never, never, never noticed me. Kept cheering, kept screaming, kept laughing at me as I starved and peed myself and slammed my head against the side till I bled. Just kept laughing and screaming through the loops and the spins and the deep dark dips that never ended, never stopped crushing. Doctor, 23512, I'm trying to help you, but acting insane won't help you in the least. There was no injury to your head at the end of the ride. D23512, I felt it. The warm on my head till it got cold and stopped spilling. Still itches. Doctor, so what happened at the end of the ride? You had a bit of an issue with 35784. D23512. She stopped laughing and giggling after all that time, and she looks at me and smiles and says, "Nice ride, eh?" And I shook her and tried to ask her why she wouldn't stop laughing and screaming. I didn't want to hurt her. Not really. Just wanted to know why. Why? 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 Repeats several times till 23512 is disabled.
Item number, SCP-396. Object class, Keter. Special containment procedures. A geolocator has been affixed to SCP-396 to track its movements. Local Foundation liaisons have been dispatched to locations where SCP-396 frequently manifests to facilitate prompt recontainment. An airborne amnestic compound has been infused into the cushions of SCP-396 and into its containment chamber as a precaution. When possible, SCP-396 is to be contained within Area 93. Foundation personnel are not to mention any location or event taking place outside of Area 93 when they are within SCP-396's containment area. Failure to comply with this can result in demotion to Level 0 and is to be treated as a disclosure of classified information. Current theories on enacting permanent containment are currently focused on finding ways to utilize SCP-396's awareness of its surroundings to create controlled environments and induce it to teleport there, which SCP-396 may become settled in repeatedly appearing. This closed-loop theory of containment is currently under consideration by the Area 93 leadership. Description: SCP-396 is a chair constructed of plastic and steel. At statistically random intervals, usually between 1 and 11 months, SCP-396 will displace itself and another chair somewhere on the planet Earth. Any living matter that is seated on SCP-396 or the seat it is displacing will also change places. This change is instantaneous. The approximate limits of this teleportation are unclear, but SCP-396 is currently believed to be able to transport itself to any location on Earth. SCP-396 was discovered in a theater in originally. It was classified as safe, as its area of effect was believed to be localized. As such, junior-level researchers were frequently assigned to work with it. It is believed that SCP-396 is able to listen to nearby conversation and transported itself to locations mentioned by its research staff. Containment procedures and classification escalated until reaching their current levels. There are currently 1,046 locations that are known to have been discussed or mentioned in passing around SCP-396 that it may affect. It has been shown to be much more likely to affect locations that were mentioned repeatedly, or in great detail. A full list is considered to be impossible, due to incomplete records of SCP-396's early time in containment. Locations SCP-396 has affected: cruise ship. Located by junior researcher Bland while on vacation, after witnessing it manifest on the deck of the ship, Bland contacted the Foundation, and classification was upgraded to Euclid upon recontainment. Theorized to have imprinted on Bland during his time working with the anomaly. Site 77, second level research floor. A researcher who had transferred from Site 77 is known to have mentioned their previous work there, which is the initial link leading to discovering the cause of SCP-396's escalation of anomalous activity. Death row. D-class personnel assigned to testing had been asked to state their name and point of origin while in a testing chamber with SCP-396. D-936816 mentioned that data expunged penitentiary at least 2 times during testing. 3 months later, SCP-396 displaced itself in the electric chair located within this facility. Due to the fact that an execution was about to be performed prior to this displacement, it was only the timely intervention of local agents that prevented major amnestic intervention from becoming necessary. Upgrade to Keter put under consideration. Area 93 washroom. Review has shown that researcher Park mentioned recent renovations to the Area 93 washroom when discussing their work environment with a colleague. Notably, this took place in a soundproof chamber, previously thought to be safe from SCP-396's anomalous effects. U.S. Supreme Court, Washington, D.C. Supreme Court Justice Abe Fortas's seat was replaced by SCP-396 after he had arrived within the building, but before taking his seat. It was not noticed until the end of that day's hearing, when Justice Fortas reported it as unusual to members of the Supreme Court police. Foundation personnel involved in the case were able to intercept documentation of the incident and recontain SCP-396. Set of talk show. A vacant audience member's chair was displaced during the live broadcast of the show, although its presence was not detected until after the show was over. Suppressed footage of the show shows that SCP-396 is clearly visible when the camera is pointed at the audience. This footage has since been replaced with a doctored copy in archives. Although recordings of the original broadcast have not been completely suppressed due to their widespread nature. Shikra Roller Coaster, Orlando, Florida. SCP-396 manifested in an empty seat during the ride's normal operation. Agents were able to recontain SCP-396 within 2 hours of displacement, as the ride was shut down following the operators noticing the unusual seating and alerting their management. Agent Elaine was commended for also suppressing the souvenir photo taken on the ride. Vatican City. Pope Paul VI was displaced, along with his throne, and appeared within Area 93, disoriented and confused. Light dosages of amnestics were able to convince His Holiness that the incident was a religious experience, and a deal was struck with Vatican City government officials to prevent widespread coverage of the incident. Addendum SCP-396-A. On 9/18/19, during regular testing of SCP-1609, the anomaly unexpectedly began to show aggression towards D-939668. However, before any personnel could be injured or killed, SCP-1609 was displaced by SCP-396. Due to SCP-396's more remote location and secure containment chamber, there were no casualties, and SCP-1609 was recontained without additional incident. After the incident, it was found that D-939668 had previously worked as a contractor in the construction of multiple GOC facilities. Security data is being reviewed to find out how SCP-396 was able to displace itself to Storage Site 8. Item Number SCP-429. Object Class Safe. Special Containment Procedures. SCP-429 is to be kept in a standard Type 3 Hazardous Object Isolation Vault. SCP-429 is not to be handled unless an attempt to operate it is to be made. Care must be taken to avoid inadvertently touching any of SCP-429's controls. Description. SCP-429 is a complex device, constructed of brass and leather, designed to fit over an individual's right hand. There are a total of 7 controls on SCP-429. 1. A lever that fits into the palm of the left hand. This is the main activation control, and is depressed when the subject has finished setting their destination. 2. A round dial near the location control 1 meets the main device. The exact function is unknown. 3. A 6-sided dial at the front of the main device. This appears to be involved in broad location selection. 4. A round dial in the center of the main device. This appears to be involved in fine location selection. 5. A lever across the clock face. The exact function is unknown. 6. A dial on the side of the clock face. This alters the clock face, although the function in selecting destination is unknown. 7. A switch on the side of the main body, not visible in filed image. Exact purpose unknown. Examination of SCP-429's inner construction reveals a clockwork mechanism connected to the exterior controls, which drives the clock face. On the exact physical duplicates of SCP-429 constructed by the Foundation, the controls are either not connected to the clockwork, controls 1, 5, and 7, or simply alter the displayed time at varying rates, controls 2, 3, 4, and 6. When a subject wears SCP-429, they gain an instinctive understanding of its operation, although they do not gain the ability to convey this information to others. If the subject visualizes a location and follows their instinctual understanding to adjust the controls, the wearer will disappear from their current location and simultaneously appear at the visualized location. Upon arrival, the controls save for 1 and 6 return to their original positions. Control 1 remains depressed until released, and Control 6 adjusts the clock face to local time. After activation, SCP-429 is inert until Control 1 is released. The subject does not perceive travel via SCP-429 as instantaneous. Each subject has reported a prolonged period of paralysis and blindness, equivalent to the time it would take to travel in a direct line between the activation location and destination, traveling at approximately 6 to 10 kilometers an hour. The biological needs of the activating subject progress as normal during this time. Therefore, journeys of more than 510 kilometers are not advised, due to the risk of dehydration. Suffocation does not appear to be a hazard, however. The controls are highly sensitive, and will move under the slightest pressure. If the controls are altered without the instinctive understanding granted by wearing SCP-429, it will disappear from its current location, and reappear somewhere within 1.76 kilometers, taking the individual who altered the controls with it. The time elapsed in such cases appears to be significantly higher than normal, with the activating subject typically arriving in a state of advanced decay. On date expunged, SCP-429 was activated remotely, via a robotic arm, equipped with a video camera and a range of sensor equipment. No data of any kind was recorded by any of the equipment, save for the onboard timing mechanism, which recorded an 8-month, 5-day, and 37-second time lapse. SCP-429 came to the attention of the Foundation after a series of seemingly impossible burglaries. The Foundation examined CCTV footage and noticed an individual, believed to be SCP-429's creator, disappearing from sight shortly before each burglary. The individual appeared to be using SCP-429 for short jumps to access inaccessible locations. The Foundation pursued this individual across 3 continents over a period of 9 years, before the individual was finally found having died of old age due to extensive use of SCP-429 in...
Lesson complete. To continue with your orientation training, subscribe to SCP Orientation right now, and make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming videos.